Welcome back to another new edition of Egypt's Parliament. And as usual, we're going to be bringing you the latest or this week's Parliament activities. And of course, we're very delighted now to have with us Dr. Mohamed Foad. He is, of course, a member of the Parliament, and he's a member for the Committee for Municipalities and Local Development. And actually, he is the official spokesperson of Al-Wafd Party. Hello, Dr. Foad. It's a pleasure to have you with us from Al-Wafd Party.
Pleasure to be here with you.
Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Would you like to start off with your activities inside the committee or as an official spokesperson? This is, of course, this is aside. You are an official spokesperson for Al-Wafd Party. But of course, Al-Wafd Party is such a political party with one of the oldest ones in Egypt with history. You are a member of one of the most important committees inside the parliament, which is the Committee for Municipalities and Local Development. There is a lot of focus over municipalities. President al-Sisi have given it a great deal during the National Conference for Youth, or the National Youth Conference earlier a month ago. So when we talk about municipalities, we have a lot to say. Before we start this episode, you told me that there are three law projects that are presented to the parliament by your committee for municipalities and local development. One of them is presented by you.
Correct.
If you would like to start with this.
Absolutely. I mean, it's a very well-known fact that the basis of corruption is the corruption which happens at the local level or at the municipal level. So a part of overcoming this is an actual overhaul of all the municipal laws that exist. The current law predates to the 70s, and it has not helped a lot because of several reasons. First, the responsibilities for the executive branch has not been clarified. The actual powers and the oversights of the local council has always been subdued. And then third, the way that the election has been done has not included all segments of the society. So we start from several mandates. The first mandate is a mandate that comes from the Constitution. The Constitution has called for two things which are very essential. First is decentralization, and that's managerial decentralization and financial decentralization. Second, it also calls for the inclusion of bigger segments of the society's persons, persons with disabilities, females,
minorities.
Minorities in general.
We wouldn't call them minorities, but they are minorities.
Yeah, exactly.
In every community.
It's affirmative action. The Constitution calls for affirmative action in the inclusion, because this is part of the society, this is how our society acts, and that's how our society should be represented. So those are the two mandates that come from the Constitution. There's another mandate that comes from the chief executive, from President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi, as you've mentioned, is a swift, which is basically a mandate to the government for a swift elections for local councils. So those are the two cornerstones that guide our activities, whether at the parliament end or at the government end. In this sense, the government has presented its law. We have three other laws which are being looked at. There is one from Dr. Mohamed Atel Fayoumi representing Al-Hurriya Party. Another is Mr. Abdel Hamid Kamel, who represents the Tagamma Party. And then there is the law presented by Mr. Ahmed Insigini and myself, representing Al-Wafd Party. So those are the laws which are currently being looked at in order to fulfill those constitutional promises, as well as to fulfill the presidential mandate.
That sounds very good, but I would like you so much to talk to us about the detail, about the idea or the law that you are presenting to the parliament, and what exactly is the target? What are you targeting from inside those details to be able to develop inside the community?
Okay, let's talk about the laws. They're all falling under three chapters or three segments. The first segment is the powers or the responsibilities for the executive branch. So what does the governor do? What can the governor do? What are the powers given to governors? The second chapter is dedicated to the oversight So local councils, what powers do local councils have? And then the third chapter is how can elections be carried out? Well, the third chapter is least important for me, at least, because we are only going to have an election once. So I mean, that's not worth dwelling about. The two sections are most important. First topic that comes under the two sections is the topic of decentralization. Mm. Well, for us to understand the magnitude of this change, you have to understand that Egypt has been centrally governed ever since the time of Mina. Mm. Okay, so basically,
he's the one that invented centralization, this idea.
The actual
thanks to him.
Thanks to the actual centralization. Yes, we are the reuniting the south
it
and
seems
the north.
Yes. Right, it is not working so far.
Yes, hasn't been. I mean, it's good because we are one country, we're united. However, in terms of management and finances, this needs to change. So, what the constitution said is that there needs to be a transitional move towards A, managerial decentralization, and B, financial decentralization. What's meant by financial decentralization and managerial decentralization means that currently it is the central government that does all the budgetary planning. So the budget is made once, it's ratified at the parliament level, and then it's the ministry MOF, it's the Ministry of Finance, and it's the Ministry of Planning that decide how these funds are trickled down to the municipal levels. What this law intends to do, with guidance from the Constitution, is to keep a percentage of the revenue earned at the local units with these local units. I'll give you an example. For instance, we say that 100% of all fees collected at the local unit level, for example, if you have parking garages, if you have fruit markets which exist, whether in villages or whether in
taxes also?
Oh, taxes will come too, because taxes is a third level, okay? Because there are two levels of taxes. So the first level is fees. So 100% of fees need to stay at the level at which they were collected, which makes sense, because if you, as a village, running the village market, there's no sense that the money collected from this market to go up to the central government only to go down again, maybe not in the same portion. So 100% of the fees collected at the local level needs to stay at the local level. The second level, which comes to your point, taxes, well, there is property tax. Mm. Now we're saying that at least 50% of property tax needs to be spent at the local level. This will have a very good impact, because it have a long-term impact on development, because each local unit will strive to make the best out of its community, because they want to raise the prices of the property higher in order to collect more taxes. So this will make sense and will help push for development. The third level of taxes, which is income tax, what we're talking about is we need to do percentages of this local tax. And this is the phase that we are in now. We're in the modeling phase, working with the Ministry of Finance, as well as working with the Ministry of Planning. We're trying to look at historical budget to see what is the appropriate percentage in order to apply the withholding necessary in order to enable this financial decentralization. So this is on the financial front.
Right. When you talk about financial front, we again cannot be wrap it up in only one question. For example, if you're talking about property tax and rising the prices and even the income tax, there is a problem, a grave problem, that is the taxes. Ever since the added value tax was admitted inside the parliament, according to in the sense of the people with the low income brackets, taxes can be a thorny issue. Of course, it is one means for development, but on the other, it could be a two-sided weapon, because it could be on the other facet something that could be annoying or daunting for those with the low income tax. Who could be supervising this process of taxes and calculating it fairly in a way that could be convenient for the community, for the citizens? Okay. And at the same time, would affect development.
Now let me respond to your question.
Especially that you are a member of parliament.
Sure. Now let me respond to your question in 3 points. First, the municipal law has nothing to do with assigning the tax percentages. All we're doing here is how the money which is being collected, be it 5%, 3%, 2%, 0%, how is it going to distribute? So we're dealing only with
how is it going to be distributed?
How is it going to be distributed? So we're not levying any more tax. As a matter of fact, the only place which is authorized to issue taxes is here. It's the Parliament only that can enact law. So this is the first part. So the first part in terms of the law will not raise any more taxes. It will just govern how tax money are distributed. So we're only dealing with the distribution of tax income.
That's also vital.
Okay.
It's very important.
Yeah. So it's basically how we're going to distribute. And basically what we're striving for is we're striving to attain fairness. Okay. So this is one part. The second part is, and this is general observation, I mean, we understand that Egypt, there is a high degree of poverty. We're basically 27%, which is basically the poverty percentage that we are
basically...
Could be
even more.
According to CAPMAS latest study. Mm-hmm. So, but we have to also recognize the fact that we are one of the lowest tax brackets being paid overall, if you compare it on a global scale. Now that moves me to the third point, which is...
And the lowest income also.
Readjustment.
At the same time.
So the readjustment means that we need to move to give tax breaks. And this is a law which has been submitted last week. We're talking about freeing up some tax brackets. For instance, people up to 14,000, earning up to 14,000 pounds per year should not be paying any more taxes. Also, adding another tax bracket to be at the 30% tax bracket, which is going to be paid to those earning more than $500,000 per year. So this is basically an adjustment.
Would you allow me to interfere here? Because
absolutely.
This is very, very, this has been the core of interest for everyone. Why should we go through all those means and dilemma when there is something that God created, which is called, we're not going to invent the wheel, which is the capital gain tax.
Correct.
And it's applied in the United States, in Europe, and everywhere.
Correct.
And in Germany. Those not even, those mean their income is even above the 5 million could pay their taxes higher than those below that.
Okay. You have three tactics.
Why aren't we applying it? Aren't we enforcing it?
You have three tactics for taxes, okay? So you have tax inclusion, which meaning including more of those who are not paying taxes, i.e. the black market or the gray economy,
important.
In the actual tax payments. So
are
this
you
is
assigned with that? Are you people in the parliament assigned with that?
Correct, yeah, there are laws for this. I'm just going to talk strategy and
please,
then we'll talk laws.
Please, yes,
so the first tactic is the inclusion, okay? So basically including some people who are not currently paying taxes to become tax paying. Second part is tax diversification, which is diversifying the mean, because the biggest percentage of tax in Egypt has always been income tax. So to your point, if you're talking about capital gain tax, dividend tax, sales tax, non-direct taxes, so this is diversification is also very important. And this will limit the exposure of the country to a one mean of tax, because people have to understand Egypt has 70% of its income in taxes. This is how Egypt brings money. 70% of our budget is made out of taxes. The third, and which should be our last resort, is raising tax brackets. So those are the three tactics that you can do. Under each one, there are currently laws which are being looked at. First one, there's a current law which is being looked into two laws. A law that has to do with how you can set up companies, which is basically we need to... And part of it will be also in the investment law, which is basically for all those shops, mom and pop shops, which are all around, for all those little basically factories, which we call them
SMEs?
Yeah, SMEs, which are not currently tax-paying. Some of the reasons why they're not tax-paying, first, because the local...
Should they be paying tax?
They should be paying tax, of course. Everybody
Should they be supported or paying tax?
Everybody should be paying tax, and this is basically part of the mind shift that should be there. I mean, they are making money, they are using electricity, they are using they are using resources from the country, so they should be paying tax.
But do they fall in the same category? That's what I'm saying.
Well,
they fall in the same category with... mega companies.
That's why I said inclusion is different from brackets. So each person or SME or company will pay an income tax or an earning tax proportionate to their earning. Some of them will even have tax breaks. As we said, if you're earning X amount, then this X amount is not considered a taxable amount. Then if you earn more, then you have a small. So this is what we call a progressive taxation. So we're trying to move more into progressive taxation. So part of it is inclusion. So basically you want to get more people who are not paying tax, because I mean you look at a small street vendor. I mean, at the end of the day, he's making ends meet.
Street vendor pay some taxes? He should be supported by the government.
Actually, this is I disagree. I do disagree. I mean, we need to set up a particular income level. Below this income level, you don't pay taxes. But otherwise, it will run out of control, because you're going to have people who will basically be asking the government to support them for basically medical care. Will ask the government to support them if there basically are any issues, are basically using public schooling, using all that, but not contributing anything to the system. So that's why we need to have actual accountability. Mm. I mean, that's all. I mean, we're not going to basically slaughter people and rob them out of money, but what we need to get is equity. So equity and equitable living, meaning that we will set the target and saying, okay, so if you're earning less than £1,500 a month, then you don't pay taxes, whether you're employed or whether you're a street vendor. But if a street vendor is making £500 a day, then by all means, he should be paying taxes, which some of them are. Okay. So that's what you need to do. So this part, the part about inclusion, and we're putting laws in order to allow for this. The second portion is about diversification. And as you said, absolutely. The biggest problem about dividend tax or capital gain tax is that we flip-flop through it. We tried to apply it, didn't work quite well with the, not that it upset the stock market, but we couldn't even get the tactics right in order to roll it out. And I'm a big proponent of rolling this tax. And then our last approach would be to do a tax hike, raise the tax bracket.
But let me get in here, and you should continue, please, after this, with what you're saying. Why is it always difficult to be able to effect this kind of tax for almost more than 40 years or 50, while it's like a piece of cake to effect the other taxes on low income brackets or the middle class or the governmental employees, who, by the way, have never had ever for years any kind of raise in their income. However, more taxes deducted.
So the biggest problem, and without getting too much into technicality, because I was very close to the subject when they were trying to affect capital gain tax, is basically the frequency of trades. Okay. Mm. So basically, because if you're basically holding a position, then selling the position, then buying again. So basically, at the end of the day, they didn't have the system set up correctly in order to account for what are capital gains. So what they attempted to do is take a capital gain tax on a transaction by transaction basis. So at the end of the day, what needs to happen, you know, I mean, if you're talking about different or other countries' stock markets, they take capital gain taxes at the end. They don't do it on transactional level, because I can sell and make a capital gain position on a stock, and then sell and make a loss on another stock, and the two will wash. Okay, so the system that they tried to apply was not sophisticated to recognize the balance between capital gains and capital losses. And they caused a lot of harm to a lot of people. I mean, they were taking taxes on gains and not recognize and not basically reconciling gains against losses. So it's a technical glitch which they were unable to overcome. Then,
why can they take it on bank accounts, on fortunes, on properties?
Okay, and I mean, at the end of the day, tax strategies, the last thing you want to do is go back and forth. Because last year, right after the Sharm el Sheikh economic convention, we've talked about different tax levers. First is capital gain tax. Second, mining law. Third is the fourth mobile operator license. Fourth is the 5% tax over those who are earning 1 million and above. Fifth which the last type of tax which was levied, which is basically value-added tax. And sorry, there was a sixth one, which is basically tax on alcohol and cigarettes. The two out of the six levers, the two which have been enacted are VAT, the value-added tax, and taxes on excise taxes on cigarettes and alcohol. And this is basically the other four. There are delays, and they need to be pushed forward in order for them to be applied.
A reflection by experts on current affairs. In-depth analysis, a balanced view of Egypt and the world around us. Expand your mind, change your world. Stay on point, on to the point. I'm going to take you to the I'm just delivering messages from laymen in the street and Egyptian community and those middle class and below people in this on the street. I mean, there are different sects of people. For example, there is a sect that is talking about governmental employees. They are the most sector that had carried the burden off their shoulders of the latest economic reforms.
Okay.
However, President Sisi have honestly mentioned that those measures or those procedures should have been taken years and years before.
That's correct.
And it's a little bit late taking them, but we had to. We didn't have any choice.
That's correct.
But then, when all those types of taxes applied and affected, it seems that they are targeting only one sector. And the reason that sector is the only target for those taxes is that because there is a problem with effecting a good program to enforce those taxes on a higher level, people with higher incomes. They haven't had a raise in years with their income, and every day they wake up, they recognize that more taxes on the newspapers are being affected. I mean, there is a problem here. How are you people inside the parliament are going to be able to monitor, for example, something like that would ease their woes, like, if you can't lift the taxes, like, for example, monitoring the market, the hikes in the prices.
Okay.
The monopoly of the different companies and the traders in the market. And mainly enforcing the tax on the wrong people.
Okay. Let me take a different view on this. The current economic situation is really hitting everybody hard. Even tycoons and businessmen who are suffered from hard currency losses in the last year. I mean, last year has been bad on everyone. And let's just try to seize what is the situation. President Abdel Fattah is absolutely right. Not only that we're paying the price for delayed action, the more delay, the more violent the repercussions, because we've waited for so long. So now we're getting the worst of the package. So let's try to think what we're facing now. What we're facing is a rampant inflation. We're looking at a 20% rate of inflation. So any forms of market controls, controlling markets, controlling prices, is not going to work. I repeat, it is not going to work. With all respect to a lot of my colleagues who are trying to work on market watches, how to manipulate the prices, you can't. Okay, so what we're dealing with is inflation. According to IMF, all throughout 2017, we're gonna see inflation rate at 17%. This year, year over year, we've seen about 22% rate of inflation, probably the highest in the past 25 years that Egypt has ever seen. And that's sad. What's normal? That's the normal course of action. Is there anything that we can do about it currently? No. Let's be frank. It is a period which unfortunately we're going to have to sustain, and because it's very simple. You're talking about a country which on the income level you have 600, you're earning 640 billion. You're spending 950 billion. You have a budget deficit about 320, and it's actually widening, this actual budget deficit. You can no longer sustain the foreign currency at the depressed level that you're doing. So you resorted to flotation because your foreign reserve can no longer subsidize this phase. So all you need to do currently is work on attracting more investment. And by attracting more investment, you're basically get more foreign currency in, ease the pressure on your budget and your budget deficit, have more income for the country to spend on development project. This is the only way it's going to, it's the classic formula. There is no magic answer that we can do now. So my message to the people is that it is what it is. It is very unfortunate, but that's the truth of the matter. We need to face the current situation as it is. There are going to be laws which are going to exclude the lowest income brackets from ever having to pay taxes. We will think about progressive taxation, raising tax levels up to the 30% to take from those people who can afford it. However, let's get the story here that this hardship, it's affecting everyone, but of course it's affecting everyone differently. But that's the nature of the beast. Those are the days that we're living in.
You raised a very important point, which is there is no magical answer to these difficulties Egypt is undertaking now. But then we could say that, for example, if we work hard day and night on attracting foreign investment, then it's going to be an inevitable circle, because in order to attract foreign investment, we have to affect the good investment law, the one window that President Sisi.
Yeah.
One-stop shop that presidency have talked about. We have to end corruption in municipalities and everywhere.
Correct.
We have to effect good laws.
Correct.
With transparency.
Absolutely.
We have to effect good fair taxes.
Absolutely.
And on top of all, democracy that we have it. We are far more better than other countries. So again, foreign investment could be a little bit late.
But this takes us back to exactly how this whole conversation
started.
So
where are we going to start from?
We go back to the beginning of the conversation. What we started with, we talked about the
maybe that is not the better start.
It's the actual municipal law. So this basically will ease the low-level type of corruption.
Exactly.
Investment law has already been approved and is coming to the parliament very soon.
I thought you were going to say something else other than municipalities. other fronts in economy.
Yeah.
That's a good answer. I mean, that's a good start to start off with them.
So basically, we're sort of firing an all engine from a legislation perspective. Mm. And also, let's not forget that the parliament also deals with oversight. So any type of irregularities that we'll observe in the markets will interfere to correct. Like, for example, the Ministry of Supplies, they're basically thinking about changing the actual inclusion of some of the segments in ration cards, and we basically will continue to oversight to ensure that the actual subsidies are reaching the target the targeted segments of society.
Mm. Exactly. Speaking about fighting corruption, lately the whole of Egypt, throughout last week and even before, have been waking up every day to find that new cases of corruption being exposed, and people are taken to court. Do you think that this has been an accumulation of years of not monitoring those particular sectors, and those are governmental officials? Employees.
Simple answer is yes. I mean,
anything to do with that in your committee?
If he sees 150 million in a person's house, he probably didn't accumulate this wealth overnight. That's probably years.
But if he effect enforce
that's probably
the
years
law?
Of hard work. Years of hard thievery. Yeah. So this has definitely been an accumulation. And absolutely, you're correct. I mean, in a lot of we're hitting in a lot of areas, not only in our committee. Of course, our committee we are concerned with any kind of irregularities that like
exactly.
co-ops that happens within the municipalities, but also elsewhere. Not only cases of fraud, but cases of negligence. For instance, myself,
exactly.
I was involved in with the committee of health with a particular irregularity the Nasser's Institute blood bank, which we uncovered some practices which did not follow protocol, which ended up in basically dismissing the actual manager of this particular blood bank. So we do a lot of those oversights day in and day out, and we're able to expose a lot of those whether irregularities or other type of issues. Same thing which we had with the Ministry of Supply when this very parliament uncovered the whole wheat supply scandal. So it's part of what we do is oversight.
And maybe in other words, it could be time, if you could cross your mind, people in the committee, to effect a very strict, clear law to be able to be enforced or affected over monitoring the process of government officials and how to monitor corruption and fraud and negligence and everything. Strict laws. And again, we're not going to be inventing the wheels, because in some European countries and in the United States and even in some Arab countries, Gulf countries, very, very strict laws are applied.
Absolutely.
I mean, chapters in the law. And we can take good experiences.
Absolutely.
Can we?
I agree, and again, we're going to have to walk in two parallel paths. One is to continue on revamping archaic laws that we have, and second is basically to do oversight. The actual promised land is where the law will be applied to a level where you're more working on legal reforms than you work on oversight. For the moment, we're going to be working in parallel paths. I'd say 70% legislation, 30% oversight.
Mm-hmm. Let me also talk about the mega projects that were inaugurated throughout last year, 2016. If this is going to be, if you are opening a new chapter in 2017, President al-Sisi has been recognized as one of Egypt's presidents as number one, the first Egyptian president to link Sinai with the rest of Egypt. One of his biggest achievements, the first Egyptian president, one of the very, very popular Egyptian president with the excellent foreign policy, and number three, or could be number one also, one of the very popular Egyptian presidents inaugurating mega projects in very little time. Of course, with the help of engineering authority of the armed forces, we have full gratitude for this particular sector. How do you assess the mega projects the many mega projects?
Well, I think there's one thing.
2016.
One thing you've also missed here.
Please.
Which I think is it's one of his biggest achievements on the economic front is resolving the electricity crisis.
Exactly.
And that's big. And I was on one of your shows 2 years ago, and we were having a very grim conversation on basically the, and it was that time in 2014, in the summer, when we were basically having the mega blackouts. And I've attended the session in the economic forum, which talks about solving Egypt's electricity crisis. And he did. And it's phenomenal. And I think it's a phenomenal achievement. And as much as people in 2014 ranted and they were very upset about it, I don't think we're getting sufficient recognition that we have went through is that we've bridged a 25% power deficit in a country of nearing 100 million people, and that's huge. I mean, it's nothing that money only can buy, but it's actually determination and good project management and good leadership. So kudos to our president for resolving this particular problem. So having said this, because I think it's very important to have said this because I believe so much in it.
Totally.
And I think that we've talked negatively so much about it, but we never really give credit to this actually happening. But all the projects that we've talked about feed into the same part of economic reform. When investment comes, if you clear in the investment environment, investment will need an infrastructure. Factories will need electricity. If you're going to go on tourism, and Sinai was basically being the heartland of our tourism package, you need to have roads that link Sinai. If you want to develop the Suez Canal and the Suez Canal industrial and developmental zone, you need to have tunnels that link this area to the rest of Egypt. So I think those mega projects will go hand in hand with the reform that you're going to have on the investment law, will go hand in hand with the reform that you're going to have on the municipal law. I think it's all part of the same loop.
Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, we can't talk about this without even giving him credit, or at least speaking on his behalf, or being fair to him, saying that regardless of all those mega projects, it couldn't be a one-man show. It can never achieve the expected success without the collaboration of good government, good ministers, a good parliament that is doing its homework and monitoring governmental officials and all the irregularities like you've just kindly mentioned, and everybody doing his homework. Do you feel that this is being affected? Because that president is working day and night, arm and hammer, but at the same time, very little results are being seen. However, you could see some people also complaining or not receiving the message that is supposed to be received. Where do you see the problem?
Well, I mean, think about this as a big elephant, and you're trying to make the elephant dance, and it's not always very easy, okay? As we've said a little while ago, a lot of the problems have been ancient problems which are deep-rooted. And you're trying to change a lot of those problems after a lot of years of delayed reaction. Delayed reaction will cause you to dig yourself into a bigger hole. So we finally came in, and the president in 2014 took the first decision of lifting some of the subsidies on gas, gasoline, and we're continuing with reforms with flotation. So it is going to be painful. There is absolutely nothing that you can do in order to make this less painful except work on providing a safety net for all those people who are in need of this safety net. However, my message again to the people, whether in Egypt or in the world, that Egypt will rise out of this a stronger nation, and as we're working to do this infrastructure, at some point of time, all of this will come together. At the end of 2017, we're expecting the natural gas out of the Zohr exploration. We're expecting a lot of the infrastructure to be in place. We're expecting the new investment law to be in place. So we're working with the right formula. It just things are going to take some time. And it's unfortunate that all of us will have to slightly suffer through this. But I think when we're going to pull through this, we're going to be a much stronger nation.
بلدي غنوة حلوة وغنوتين حلوة يا بلدي كلمة حلوة وكلمتين حلوة يا بلدي غنوة حلوة وغنوتين حلوة يا بلدي
While we are talking about this, you could find other people, I mean, delivering, still delivering the message from inside the Egyptian street, other people and some economic analysts and people saying that where could we find some successful experiences who lifted up the subsidies in their countries or were granted the IMF loan, but it did not succeed. All the experiences surrounding us in the world were failures as countries who were granted loans from IMF. And one of the major experiences that we could take a look at was the Russia, for example, and parts of South America, and Greece, and I mean other countries. So this raised doubts in the streets, especially with the hiking prices. The case of plateau in the income of the governmental employees.
I mean, we have to set expectations correctly. And what I like about the president has done ever since day one, even through the campaigning time before he became president, through the elections, he's always been trying to set the expectations straight, meaning that we have tough times ahead, and that's the truth of the matter. I mean, let's look at some numbers, okay? Mm. So, the governmental sector, January 24th, 2011, total salaries, 80 billion. Right now, 250 billion. Okay, so it's four times as much. Okay. So included a lot of people, taking over a lot of people into the government sector. Subsidy spending. Okay, January 24th, 2011, was the tunes of 50 to 60 billion. Now subsidy spending 170 billion. So countries doing more in terms of actual subsidy and actual work on those areas. However, what you need to look at in terms of the actual IMF experience, one of the bright side is the experience that Brazil had. So basically, what Brazil did is, it's important for the IMF to understand, or it's important for the in order for the IMF to be involved, is for them to understand is that what money is being paid for an actual structural reforms. Structural reforms meaning that this money is not going to go into a vicious circle. So they're not gonna lend us money in order to buy some wheat, to bake some bread, to eat. But this is a never-ending story because
importation or yeah, importing is, yeah, and exporting. Yeah, this is not, a yeah. here is the very
this is not
going
to work.
Idea.
What they want to ensure is that if they're going to lend us some money, we're going to restructure our budget in a way where this money is not going to go directly into subsidies. We're not going to take IMF money in order for us to subsidize people importing goods at £8.88. This is not going to work. So if you look at the Brazilian experience, it's actually been a success. It's one of the successful experiences dealing with IMF. And to be honest, as a parliamentarian, although the parliament still needs to approve the IMF loan, it's not a fact of reality according to Article 127 of the Constitution unless the parliament approves it. So, I mean, we're still in preliminary phases with the IMF. Whether or not we've received the first tranche, it has no bearing because the parliament still needs to approve this particular loan. However, I have to say that I'm cautiously optimistic about the actual IMF involvement because you have to recognize that during the time of ex-president Morsi, there have been so many approaches that the presidency at that time tried to make with the IMF, and the IMF would not come near Egypt. Okay, so the actual involvement of the IMF is actually giving this country an actual positive outlook that we actually have a credible progress in place. Because in 2012, 2013, the IMF would not approach Egypt at all. But now, because we have a president who's been fairly and democratically elected and is incredible, we have a parliament which has been credible and which has been actually fairly and democratically elected. So you have the actual executive and legislation branch and the parliament and in the parliament in place. Now IMF is actually doing business with us, and it's important to recognize that this is actually a very positive move. Of course, borrowing is never positive in its own, but it's a fact. But it's a fact of reality that we have an endemic budget deficit, and we need to work on rectifying this over time.
But then again, if you look over situation of borrowing, like I like the term that you gave it, or the loan, world experiences, we could say that you talked about the first tranche. We can never be granted loans without applying or complying with the conditions that the IMF have set for the country that is about to be granted those loans, like for example controlling how the money is spent. One of the cases is not spending them on national projects because it consumes liquidity.
Correct.
So there are conditions.
Correct.
For this loan that has to be taken very seriously and implemented very strictly. Maybe it could not be suitable at that time as we're coming out of two revolutions.
That's why we're sourcing, we're diversifying into the sourcing of loans. That's why we deal with World Bank. If IMF finances structural changes and directly budget related, World Bank will finance actual projects. So that's why we're mixing and matching between finances. It is very important and crucial for Egypt to be involved with the IMF, because the IMF will help Egypt shore a lot of the financial practices, and it actually will help govern a lot of our monetary policy. So I take a contrary approach to a lot of people think about IMF as a colonial power. Well, no, IMF is not a colonial power. They're not trying to get Egypt to do something that we don't want to do. At the end of the day, they want to establish a win-win situation, okay? And we always have to remember, the IMF did not come looking for us. We went looking for them. And that's their role. I mean, their role has been historically to be involved with government to help bring about structural reforms. So we're going to have to comply with what we believe as a sovereign country, what we believe is correct and fair and equitable for us to do, and we will do it. If we believe there are terms which are not good for us to do, Egypt, its government and its president is not going to sacrifice it alone. I mean, and that's something which I am absolutely sure of.
Right. Shall we look over the health file?
Absolutely.
Do you have reservations over the health file? Because Egyptian people have. The Egyptian citizens.
The health.
I think that file you would have your hands full monitoring.
The health segment has also a pandemic issue, which all the segments are suffering from, which we suffer from the actual devaluation. The currency devaluation has brought about an increase in a lot of the segments. For example, we have renal dialysis. I'm an MP. I represent Omraniya from Giza. In Giza, we have over 60,000 people, patients, who do renal dialysis twice or three times on a weekly basis. So the actual subsidy that the government pays per person is £140 per session. Now, those £140 are now not enough at all because the centers which are providing them with the renal dialysis can no longer continue to be operative, can no longer function on £140 per session. I mean, the actual money is close to 200 and 220. So each center is in deep need of getting further subsidy.
You mean public hospitals or centers?
Whether public or private centers.
Because should be working on health insurance. I mean, because that's why people pay tax for, and it's applied everywhere in the world.
Still, they need to redeem, whether public or private, they're redeeming per session from the government. I mean, there are rack rates. There are actually rate cards for each activity because each hospital, whether private or public, will redeem this money from the government against sessions which are delivered. In this sense, they were doing 140 per session. 140 is never enough now after the increases in prices and the equipment and the supplies. So finally yesterday, the government and the cabinet has taken the decision to raise the subsidy on healthcare by £4.5 billion in order to account for the fight against virus C, which we've been doing a very good job at as a country, the actual healthcare increases for renal dialysis.
And what's your own assessment? Because this could, if you like to elaborate more on that particular point, raising the subsidies the health insurance or over some.
It's basically raising the allotment for health insurance in general by 4.5 billion. And this is to serve several segments. For example, renal dialysis will benefit about 600 million pounds will be allotted to renal dialysis. You have about 1 billion which will be raised to the fight against virus C and the provision of the Sovaldi drug because we're targeting the eradication of this particular disease within the coming 20 years. So there is more that needs to be done in this particular field, and its finances. Two segments which are very investment or not investment, which are very money sensitive: education and healthcare. Education and healthcare. So the remedy for education and healthcare is always money, is always spending.
So again, we're going to start off with our main question that we started off with the episode. Unfortunately, we ran out of time, but I'm going to leave you with a promise that we can continue on the educational file later on with more episodes, Your Excellency, Member of Parliament, Dr. Mohamed Foad, and official spokesperson for a law of the party. Thank you very much. And I guess we can elaborate more on educational file in another episode of Egypt's Parliament. Thank you, sir.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It was my pleasure. And I guess this is where we end this edition of Egypt's Parliament. We'll see you again next week. Until then, goodbye.